So Fiona is a senior lecturer at the University of Otago, Wellington, working from Christchurch. Fiona teaches distance-based postgraduate coursework in rehabilitation. Her research interest is enabling children's participation through more effective ways of working with their caregivers. And Fiona is presenting this. Unfortunately, she was sick last time. Mm-hmm. She was meant to be here at the peer group, so it's nice that you came back and gave us a second chance.
Susan, what on Wednesday I was looking at the dice this week. Children at the suck up germs phase, so there's a lot flying around their house. And thanks for the opportunity to come again. It's always great fun and to come to Baylor. Such a wonderful, unique crowd of people that are really committed to improving the lived experience for people with disability and thinking about disability and rehabilitation from quite a broad perspective. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be here. Occupational performance coaching is an approach to intervention that I articulated within my own PhD studies, which I finished about 6 years ago. And so it's continued to be a component of my pathway of research. What I'm going to share with you today is a study that I conducted here in New Zealand, looking at how other therapists other than myself might learn and use coaching. So, similar to what Rebecca was sharing with us a minute ago, actually, about what was it that led her to her research question, mine very much came from a clinical questioning about how effective was I really being with families. Tease out the differences but just between whether the family likes spending time with me, whether I was actually being useful to them. And I tended to assume that I wasn't being useful unless I had very strong evidence to the contrary. So I asked a lot of questions. I started to think a lot about what was effective help giving as I increasingly started to spend time working with the caregivers of children with disabilities rather than working directly with the children themselves. And at that time, I was particularly unskilled at being able to have conversations with caregivers in ways that made them able to do something different in their lives. And the kind of client group I was working with at the time tended to be this sort of mid to low socioeconomic group, tended to often have quite complex lives, reasonably often clients to fairly chaotic lives. And so suggesting to them that they need more routine into their life or were more consistent with their children didn't tend to make much difference to the way that they actually go about living. So I started to think about what I was doing and ultimately I started to use what I came to call coaching with the caregivers, where there was a very strong basis to the relationship, high attention to empathy and the development of trust, and a lot of asking questions to caregivers about what they thought might work, rather than giving advice, which was the predominant model at the time, both in the literature and where I worked. And as I started to work in this way more often, I started to become questioned by my colleagues about what I was doing. As an occupational therapist, I should perhaps be focusing on fine motor skills and sensory processing, aspects of child impairment and maybe activities that the service was sort of set up for. That's what the service structures encourage therapists to do. So I was also interested to know, well, if we take a coaching perspective, we'll be working with the caregiver as the change agent rather than the therapist as the change agent, does this in fact sit within occupational therapy theory? Hence the slightly clunky name I came up with, occupational performance coaching, which I kind of go to cringing about and feeling glad that I did it. Ultimately, OPC, Occupational Performance Coaching, is focused on enabling participation in occupations that matter. So within occupational therapy literature, and I don't think there are any OTs here today. Within the OT theories, this is very much what we're on about supporting people to occupy themselves in the activities that they value in roles and activities that they value. And I see evidence to frame this as enabling participation for those of you like Brendan, who are the gurus on more interprofessional frameworks for rehabilitation. Okay. So it's directly around enabling participation in the things people value, and it's a highly client-centered approach. The occupational therapy has adopted the term client-centeredness as sort of a mere branding, almost. But when it comes to unpacking, what does that really mean, apart from being nice to people and liking people? We need a bit more detail there, and that is articulated within this model. It's a highly goal-focused approach, where considerable time is spent initially setting meaningful goals with caregivers, goals that the caregiver finds very meaningful, and these become central throughout the rest of the work together. And essentially, the intervention is a reflective discourse or a reflective conversation where the therapist creates opportunity for the caregiver to reflect on what is happening in this situation, what are their observations of the child, and what is it that might work to make things better. There is an intention to emphasise caregiver knowledge and strengths and techniques within the model to explicitly elicit this. largely for their influence in supporting caregiver motivation to make changes. Often the situation with those chaotic families I mentioned a moment ago is a lack of a sense of personal authority to be able to do something differently, a lack of a capacity to be able to do that, rather than they're not interested in doing it at all, doing something at all. And drawing again on occupational therapy theory is the attention to the match between the child, the task, and the environment, and guiding caregivers to identify ways to create a better match when the child's ability matches the task and the environment, or more relevantly, when the task and the environment match the child's ability, they're more able to engage in successful practice, build skills, build competence, and avoid a lot of those stressful kinds of situations that Rebecca was describing a moment ago. So I won't go about the model in detail, but it's essentially conceptualised in these three enabling domains, and at different times the therapist draws on heightening attention to structure, structured problem solving, provision of emotional support or a supportive relationship. Joe, can I get a drink of water, please? Hot water would be fine. And in particular, attention to the use of empathy to strengthen the connection with the caregiver. There is an adage that people need to know that you care before they will care what you know. And it's very much starting from that premise of showing that you care and using this specific technique. The idea of information exchange. Aside from advice giving, the other predominant models used regarding interactions in pediatric rehabilitation is advice giving / educating. And I think that the terminology has changed a little bit, but in reality, the action hasn't changed very much at all. And therapists do predominantly tend to use an advice giving kind of scenario, giving advice and information. And as Rebecca illustrated in some of the research she presented, provision of information is considered a key component of good family-centred practice. And I would argue that we need to tease that apart a little bit more, because very often when you get better at asking people questions about what they already know, they probably don't quite need as much of your advice as what you thought. And they're in a much more empowered position of making change if attention has been brought to what they already know, rather than reinforcing that they are in a position of incompetence and the lack of power and authority, and the health professional is in the position of being the expert. These ideas very, very much align with self-determination theory, and the idea that when people feel more autonomous, they have a sense of control over their life, when their needs for relatedness are met, when they feel connected and understood to the healthcare provider, and when they have a higher sense of their own competence. So that's being competent and perceiving yourself as competent. They're in much stronger positions to do something different and sustain doing it differently. do it in such a way that it's more likely to be effective. In terms of the journey of OPC research, it's not even as tidy as this chart makes it look, and it's not a particularly tidy chart in reality. I very much came at this from the ground up as a clinician with an interest area. So for the researchers among you, you can like to find it amusing. But my questions basically led to another. What was I talking about when I first went to study my PhD, and ended up being OPC? And then the next obvious question was, well, does it work? And that was one of the studies that I completed in the PhD. And then, but that of course opened up to another bunch of questions about, well, how does it work? What parts of it particularly work? Are the parts that are not so relevant? Can it be learned by other therapists? Because so far I'm the only therapist that's done the delivery of the intervention. So has it been described in such a way that it can be learned? And can it be applied in the everyday clinical context that most pediatric therapists are working in? I've so far today tested it with, essentially within research situations where a family has responded to an invitation to research. And for those of you who've done a bit of research, you know that you don't get your standard cohort when you send out an invitation to take part in research. You get the most yumsy scrumsy of families that would even have turned up to the child development service here that it doesn't work for. And what influences how it's applied? And these are very important questions for me to unpack before it would be appropriate to go on and conduct a randomised controlled trial about the effectiveness. I studied so far about the effectiveness was a few rungs down the ladder in terms of quality, which some of you picked apart at the critical appraising session we had a couple of weeks ago at my invitation. So this study that I'm presenting to today is about what are pediatric therapists' perceptions of implementing coaching and and what are the contextual factors that they think impact on its use. So I offered, and this again I'll share just a little bit more than this is around this project again for the, there's a lot of researchers in the group and emerging researchers. So I conducted a study in New Zealand. I offered 2 days free training and coaching, which I would normally charge $5,000 for. I offered free flights and accommodation to Christchurch for the training, and I think at that point I had about 5 participants. So I offered another site training in the North Island. In the end I got 19 participants, and I had to also open it up to physiotherapists and speech and language therapists because there were not enough people signing up to the study. So there was a big lesson for me in terms of really the size of the population in New Zealand. There's like 2,500 registered OTs in New Zealand, and probably 700 of them, 500 of them work within the paediatric area. I'm going to have to be very creative if I do another study on effectiveness in New Zealand. I'm not going to be able to do the classic randomised controlled trial session within New Zealand because there's simply not enough population. You need a really big great base by the time you get therapists that'll be interested in taking part in research. The main research question in the study was in fact to test the fidelity of OPC and to have therapists voluntarily sending videos of themselves using coaching on a session with a real client where they felt that they could use coaching, so they could pick the video. It was like, under best conditions, can it be taught, and can people do it in the way that it was intended? So I didn't have enough data to conduct that research. And in the end, I got 10 videos from 6 therapists, and I needed about 30 in order to conduct the analysis. So fortunately, I tacked on a little qualitative question that was going to cost almost nothing until the grant application, and explored therapists' perceptions of the intervention and the contextual factors. So, as I said, therapists had the training, and the training was 2 days, and it focused on exploration of values as well as teaching of the techniques, because therapists' values around their role with caregivers influences the way they obviously behave and practice quite a bit. So we explored that. If the values didn't align, then they weren't going to adopt any of the techniques, no matter how well they taught them. I used quite a lot of role modelling, quite a lot of videoing of myself, and I did a lot of demonstrations. demonstration, so it was a highly inviting participatory kind of workshop. And they had an optional video conference follow up after 2 months. The people that signed up for the study were mostly OTs, so we had four physios, I think. I think this data here actually relates to the ones that continued on through to the, so just check those numbers for you. So 19 therapists is the largest study, that's why 16 took part in the interviews, and 4 of them were physiotherapists. They're largely European, but quite New Zealand European, but quite a few overseas trained therapists. No therapists were identified as Māori. They were largely employed in the public sector. And the interesting thing here is that they have very high level of clinical experience. So it's interesting to note, and I've since sort of noticed this trend in workshops, is that it tends to be of interest to more experienced therapists. Younger therapists do not tend to sign up for workshops in this model, they definitely attracted the older demographic. So it might say something about clinical journey. So what were the results? What was it like to implement? And what were some of the contextual factors that impacted on it? There was an overarching it's a little bit hard to see in this light, listening better. Things to listen better. And I'm just going to go speak at this level today because there's quite a few themes. But it changed the way that they listened to families. Parents in particular, and that in itself created a quite a sequelae of differences in the way therapy panned out for them. And these were represented by shift in power sharing with caregivers, shifts to the way that they prioritised what they spent time on in therapy, and in themselves as therapists they described feeling that they're finding a liberating approach, but still challenging. And there were some, not many, but some OT and physio differences came through in the data. So listening better. So there was a perceived shift in practice towards greater time and attention to the use of listening. It's permeated all of the other descriptions therapists have. This sort of goes hand in hand with the use of empathy. So kind of listening is what they did while they were empathising. They were thinking about, they were focusing on empathising, and what they did was spend more time listening to caregivers. This impacted on the way that they shared power with caregivers, because they were creating more opportunities for the caregivers to do their own reflection, and listening to the caregivers' reflection. I've got a couple of quotes here to illustrate. So having that same ability to wait for an uncomfortable answer or give them time to respond, not assuming that any of us have the answers. So quite a shift, shifts described in terms of that shift away from being the expert, needing to be the expert and having the answers, through to seeing proactively using listening. It's more around, I'm going to come and sit beside you and then kind of look and see what the world looks like from your direction. If you understand that, then you start to get some other insights. And I think these kind of comments are quite interesting given that they're from very experienced, and I would say very confident therapists. I run a lot of workshops with clinicians, and these would have been certainly at the more confident end of the scale. It's recognising that there's things around grief and that they need to deal with early on. Rather than trying to work with this family for a year, then nothing changes and you wonder why. Because you didn't really listen. Really listening, especially in the initial stages of contact. It seemed to clarify the overall direction of therapy when they had used used listening model at the start. They had more to go on because they sought more specific information for caregivers. This is a little bit long, but again, this quote's from very experienced and very confident. occupational therapist. And it illustrates how it's had a small, a bit incremental effect on the way that therapy kind of played out. But people always really looked at what their needs were, and I was, well, a little bit introspective. I think I was always empathetic. This resonates again with what Rebecca said. I was already family-centred. I went through that period of listening to them, I would have, and tried to understand them. But, you know, when it came to, well, what do we actually work on, I was much more prescriptive about that. And I did go through, you know, the whole ABC process of getting them to define what the goals are and what was doable for them, you know, and I didn't go hand it over as much to you. I didn't check with them as much to say, you know, is this doable for you? These things she's referring to are kind of some of the key techniques with them, ABC, you know, and I didn't. But if I felt they were a little bit hesitant, I didn't say, you know, I didn't reflect back to them. So I'm doing that now. So now I'm doing that. So, look, very subtle, but quite immediate changes. So empowering, addressing this theme here now. So a shift in power sharing. So this was kind of a two-way thing. They ended up kind of empowering families by creating opportunities for them to be able to realise what their own skills and competence were, what their own knowledge was. And they gave them a chance to do some problem solving by creating opportunities to reflect. So they were empowered through reflection and by allowing the caregiver to show their expertise without coming in with advice, they ask questions to elicit the caregiver's expertise. And by creating the expectation that caregivers had some authority managing the situation. Mum said, wow, I didn't realise how the day looked and how little time I actually had and how long I was putting them in front of cartoons. And if I want them to be able to use his hands and feet, well, how am I going to get him to do that? So you can see there how that caregiver was empowered simply by being given the opportunity to reflect on what the day was meant to look like. Again, very similar, not dissimilar to the example that we gave a moment ago. And again, similarly, the therapist here has created the opportunity for the caregiver to demonstrate their own knowledge. So she avoided the need to give advice, and in doing so, very much empowered that caregiver to problem solve. So instead of saying, well, how about taking a photo of the centre and giving it to him while he's in the car and preparing the child for going to the centre, I said, well, how else could you prepare him? And she said, she just came up with it and said, of the centre. And I said, oh great. We're so used to being an expert and just saying, this is what I think you should do. Again, a very experienced and very confident therapist. Now this ethical dilemma thing, I think it was important to share and represent the themes. It wasn't as an outer message in the data as the sort of the effect on listening. But there's some qualifications to this, and particularly around power sharing. Several therapists raised concerns about giving so decision making to the caregivers. If I tell them then they can decide in therapy whether they need any help or not, they might say no. And some therapists got quite uncomfortable about this. When I ask them about what kind of strategies they think they might work, and they say a strategy that I don't agree with, some therapists found this very difficult. And sometimes parents said, strategies like, I would wash this down that with soap. You know, and from a, you've obviously given you that as a health professional, and it's a mild form of child abuse. In presenting this work in Singapore recently, the therapist said caning is a very, very common child management strategy still. And so that was the example that they came up with. I feel a lot less comfortable about caning than I do about washing the child with soap, but I certainly wouldn't recommend neither. The interesting thing, of course, is that these things are going on anyway. It's just that when they use the coaching approach, caregivers disclosed it to the therapists. Mm-hmm. So it's a positive sign, top sign, in terms of trust, but it did make it uncomfortable for some therapists about how they would deal with it. But where I'm getting with it myself is that the family actually turn and say, you know, I don't actually have a problem. My child's got a severe disability, and there's nothing I can do about it. So I don't want intervention anymore. Now, interested, maybe in question time, and I'd like you to think about how comfortable you are with that statement. Reprioritising. So again, it sort of stemmed from the fact that they listened much more attentively to the caregivers. There were several shifts in the way that they spent their time through the rest of therapy. So they spent more time generally on goal setting and setting that goals that were more meaningful, more central to the overall therapy process and more explicit. So goal setting, as many of you know, is widely regarded as best practice in rehabilitation generally, but certainly within pediatric rehabilitation, it is one of the few things with reasonable supporting evidence. And clearly most people aren't doing it. I suppose that is not really that surprising. So if goals are more meaningful, just look at this first bit for a start. Because I come in with everything, I can come in with everything that I think of, and if it's not a goal that's important to her, well, I think that's where it's all fallen down in the past. So seeing again that is sort of central and fundamental to what she does with the rest of the time. And this is another, again, interesting example of the series of subtle changes it makes to the way the therapy played out. Well, before the training, I wouldn't have been so specific with my goals. A little bit more general, is the child more manageable? Is the child playing better? Is the child more compliant? But whereas this is very, very specific and very incremental. And what I think I can see is that the specifically worded goals really seem to focus her attention. And I find that particularly interesting because I haven't really actually thought about coaching like that myself, so that's interesting how she's put it. Flexible servicing. So the therapist became more flexible in the way that they delivered services. So instead of, a lot of therapists described that they tended to offer a block of 10 sessions when the child's time came up, and they tended to see people in their own homes. Most of them were employed in child development services. And they tended to assume that the caregiver wanted the maximum amount of input that the service could offer. What they found was that caregivers often asked to see people less often asked to contact over the phone or on email, and terminated services sooner than they thought. So just bear in mind that this is a highly participatory intervention from the caregiver's point of view. There's explicit conversations about the actions the caregivers were going to be doing in between visits. And in the least conditions, their caregivers often described not wanting to see people as often and in different ways. And you can imagine what the resource implications for some of those examples are. Well, I'm a lot more flexible now in how I structure the sessions, where it happens, doing more phone calls and emailing, whatever it takes. And a lot more sessions without the kids actually there. And in terms of, because caregivers can have much more fuller conversations when the child is present, and sometimes some of what they might talk about is not very appropriate if the child's there. But that does have implications for some services because they are funded based on face-to-face child therapist contact. Mm-hmm. And a re-evaluation of time. This came up a lot. Time came up a lot. Some described that they spent less time with families, and some described that they spent more. But there was certainly a shifting of time around goal setting and rapport, more time there, and then services tended to take them after that. Feeling useful. So liberating but challenging. They described feeling very effective, and this tended to be related to sort of higher levels of engagement from the caregivers, probably because they were listening more fully to the caregivers and were focusing more on caregivers' medical goals. But that's me talking a little bit as a clinician. Obviously, you can't test those relationships in this type of data. Connection was effortful. Now, this is the bit that came up for more physios than it did for OTs. So they talked about how hard it was emotionally to hear what was really going on for families. And also, actually, just like what a cognitive effort it was to listen. Now, OTs also talked about this as well, but I think all the physios talked about it, and some of the OTs did it some of the time. So, again, it's only a, you know, four in terms of the physios, but I think it is interesting. Just leave it at that for now. The therapist described actually how difficult it was to not give advice, and they used the term sit on my hands, to not give advice and to not do things with the child. And And I love this comment from the Jane that I couldn't actually say that I can stop getting that white belt once a year. This is 3 months after the training. She actually couldn't do it. Which I think, with all respect to her, it really attests to the contextual drivers on her to give them hands-on help as a therapist. I mean, yeah, there's a system around that, experience of her. So what are the implications for this? Well, going back directly to my research question, as you do when you do your discussion, was it learnable? How did they perceive it? So they perceived it to be learnable and applicable and relevant in their therapy context, and that's for the OTs and physios. They particularly described higher attention to the use of empathy, listening, and meaning-focused goals. Every one of these points has another half a dozen research questions on it, but I'll just draw your attention to a couple of them. Some of what they described as being the challenging aspects of implementing it in terms of the context were around what other health professionals thought of what they were doing and how some of these service structures were arranged. And I would wonder, how far have we really got with being family-centred? Because this occupational performance coaching is really one way of operationalising things into practice, which we're all supposed to be doing anyway. Yet therapists are telling us it's distinct from what they were doing, and that some of these service structures don't enable you to do it. One therapist made the comment, well, we can't do it in teams in terms of the service. It couldn't be done as a team-wide approach because you couldn't have everyone asking caregivers what's most important to them. I'd be really interested in your view on that. And I can see where she's coming from with that. She's really working in a tiny, multidisciplinary, siloed approach. Yeah, it would be a bit of a drag, maybe getting asked time and time and time again what's really important to them. Or, you know, if there was a more collective way of providing services, maybe that would be a really nice point of consistency. And other therapists said that it could only be done as a team-wide approach, and describe situations where they've done joint sessions with other therapists, and one had posed questions, what do you think about working with the situation, and the other therapist had jumped in and answered it, and made the coaching therapist look like she didn't know. That's why she was asking a question. So, more questions than answers, probably. I hope to submit this next week. But I'm very interested in your comments, particularly as you're probably not as immersed in the pediatric and family centred literature as well. I am. Yeah.
Thank you.